presentation. The purpose of this study was to kind of see how close or how deep can we get using dense stream marker. So we know that we mostly use the sensor pointing marker panels, which consist of 50 to 150 stream markers. So we were interested to see can we get what more information can we get if we do whole genome stream analysis instead. So what markers do we normally use? We use STR markers normally for regular casework, and there are a few of them that we use. Each marker, of course, has a lot of information in terms of polymorphic information. There are not so much freely available genotype data. Of course, a lot of that access to their own data sets. In comparison, if you look at stream markers, there are a lot of freely available genotype data that you can download. I'll get back to where you find these data sets. Of course, stream markers can contain a lot of other information that STR markers normally don't. So stream markers are used crucially in routine work in many other fields like epigenetics, genealogy, and there are a lot of these markers. So we normally do kind of a whole genome SNP analysis, we get maybe 500,000 markers to analyze. So how do we get some main markers, or how do we get the genotypes? There are basically two different methods. One is sequencing, and sequencing here means whole genome sequencing. It's still fairly expensive. I think just roughly about $2,000 for the genome, at least in Norway. Good thing with the whole genome sequencing is that we can use it on trace amounts of DNA, so if we have like a very small amount of DNA from, for instance, a crime scene, we can usually get some, a lot of information using sequencing. Problem with the sequencing output is that it needs a bit of processing before we can actually compare it to the data, the reference data sets. In contrast, we have a microarray chip, which is very cheap. I think $200 is probably too much. I think it's almost down to maybe $50 for a chip. And it's used by the so-called direct-to-consumer companies. Maybe you've heard of them, 23andMe, Ancestry. They've been a bit media attention about those lately. It needs usually a fair amount of DNA, so usually you need a good saliva or blood sample to get a good profile. You can perform a whole genome amplification to get DNA. So normally you need a fair amount of DNA. The output is easy to compare with any of the reference data sets we have. So the reference data sets we've been using, this is, you see a number of them here. We have already heard a bit about the HGDP, which is a big collection of cell lines from different populations. And we have the 1,000 genomes, which was a study that set out to get like the whole genome sequencing from 1,000 genomes. I think it's like 2,500 genomes now. From different populations, you see that on the map here of those. And we also had access to the Swedish data set, and of course, samples from two authors here. So first author, sent this sample to one of the direct-to-consumer companies in the US and got the results, which is based on a customized human microarray chip. The first author, the raw data was analyzed internally on the F-metrics migration. Basically, the output from these chips is are similar. We get like 600,000 SNP markers. And of course, we can find out a lot of other information. We found out, for instance, that we need to drink about 3 cups of coffee today or each day to satisfy our needs in terms of coffee. And of course, we can find a lot of other information. Our study here was to find out if we can use this large number of markers to kind of pinpoint our ancestry a bit deeper than just likelihood of observing our genotype in population, given that we know the lead frequencies of that population. The second one was the second set of methods is called PCA and NDS, and we've seen a few plots of this. So basically, these are methods to reduce the genotype stem dimension, which is in like 500,000, we can reduce it to 2 dimension and just see, kind of visualize this in a better way. The third is called structure. It's a bit more advanced. You can actually find the admixture proportion of each individual, given that we have good reference data sets. So, yeah, before, I think I basically kind of show mostly on the three first ones here. Okay. Starting with the maximum likelihood method, we use genotype frequency, as I mentioned, from reference population, and we can use both on the SNP and the STAR markers as long as we have the reference data sets. It's sensitive to linkage asymmetry problem that I talked about in my previous talk. So we need to consider this when we compute the likelihoods. Yeah, and I think this is not good on the Sprite database. From a single marker and CVA lead frequencies vary a bit between different global populations. The second method, which is PCA or NDS, I think we're actually going to use NDS, the NDS method. So it basically captures, as I said, like based on these 500,000 markers, it captures the most variation, or actually in NDS, the most similarities. And it's actually quite nice here in this plot. We see that Africa kind of creates its own cluster to the right. So yeah, there are a lot of different African populations. We have the Eastern Asian populations clustering really tightly in the left corner here. The Europeans cluster kind of in the left top, while we have other mixed populations, some Americas, the Americas, and Central, like Central Asia populations here. So this is basically based on the 1,000 genome data sets. There's also been a recent study based on just kind of to see what can we do in terms of Europe. And they, yeah, I think this plot is really nice. It kind of did the same analysis. And if you look really closely, you can see that this map, where we have actually looked at each individual, kind of resembles the map of Europe. So, and they also found out that using kind of a regression method, they could pinpoint the location of kind of the birthplace of these persons within, I think, 300 kilometers in range. Is really good. Unfortunately, these data sets are not available, so we couldn't use this. Yeah, this is just another one from another study where we have Norwegians, Swedes, and Denmark. We can see kind of a similar pattern here. Actually, this is Danes, these are Norwegians, no, these are Swedes, and these are Norwegians. Kind of, you can imagine this to be the map of Sweden, Norway, and Denmark, anyway, because it's a bit rotated. Yeah, and the last thing before going into the results here is the structure. So what we see here at the bottom is actually the decomposition of each population in the world. And we see that each color here represents kind of the subpopulation. I think I'll get back to that when I show the results instead. Okay, let's start quickly with the first author. And we actually did the ancestry, just picked out the ancestry from the markers in the, I think there are like 165 ancestry markers here. And we can see that for the first offer, we're pretty closely in Europe or Middle East. I guess their likelihood ratio is about 100 in favor of Europe. So mostly saying that Europe is probably the most likely population. We can also use, in this case, we can use 16,000 markers in markers instead. And we see that the final scale probability is 99.5% probability of Sweden. Of course, this is only based on the reference population we include here, so the genome geographer would be quite maybe a better alternative if you don't have the population, the real population. And again, these are basically the plots I was telling you about. the black spot here is actually the author. So we see that in both, when both compared to the Gaussian genome data set and the HGDP, this person, no, that's actually me, clustering closely with the Europeans. Yeah, and this is actually the Sweden only. So basically, these are different parts of Sweden, and you can kind of, it's kind of difficult, but there's some kind of pattern north to the left and south to the right, and we can see that this author clusters with the southern parts of Sweden. So we can move on here to the second author. It's kind of the same here. I think the second author has only been typed on like 50 of the SSP markers. Still, the likelihood ratio is about 1,000 maybe in favor of the European population compared to the Middle East population. It's surprising when compared to the second author with the 1,000 genome and the other population using 16,000 markers, we get a high zero predicted for the northwestern European population instead of the Swedes. So a bit surprising. Yeah, and basically we've got the same plot set I showed you before. We see that the second author is pretty nicely within the Europeans, the European cluster. And also if we plot the second author in Sweden, we see that he's kind of in the middle of the southern Sweden population. Yeah. So briefly as a summary, this is another plot where we actually plotted both our authors, but this is actually grouped. So we have Finland down here, Sweden, UK, kind of the Mediterranean, Italy and Spain, and then we have Sardinia here. And we see that both authors are pretty fits nicely with the Swedes, kind of also close to the UK population here. So we also try to see, try to recreate this plot using fewer markers, and I think this is based on 16,000 markers. So we start with just 100 markers. So these are not 100 markers that carefully selected. And of course, if we want to kind of use only 100 markers, we need to kind of see, we need to look a bit more, well, does this marker actually test? But if we just randomly select 100 markers, we see that there is little. And there's just a lot of different nice colors in a big blur. If we use 1,000 markers, we'll see that kind of there is some pattern here with some green individuals kind of clustering to the left, scaling this information. If we use 10,000 markers, we'll see that we start to see a pattern here, kind of the same that we saw before. And if we use all the 16,000 markers, we'll see that again, So the message here is that either we have to carefully select markers, which is basically what we've done with the SSP quantum markers, of course, or we can also use a lot of markers, and then this analysis will basically use the markers with the most information in them. Yeah, and the last thing before finishing here, I thought I would show you the end mixture. I told you about the structure and analysis you can do. But basically, we have this is these are number of European populations, and we can see. And then, so each line here represents an individual of that population. And this analysis kind of assumes some kind of overarching populations. In this case, we consider two populations, and we'll see that if we only consider that Europe consists of two populations, we see that the Finn